I'm the maintainer of Krita, which is a raster paint application, and this is Cyril Berger, one of our developers. Before I start, I'm really interested to know how many of you are developing free software graphics applications and how many of you are using graphics applications. So let's have the developers first. And are they users? Right, users are the majority, that's good. I'm not sure about that, because one of the things I've noticed while working with Krita is that I have precious little time left to actually use my application.
I don't. Yes.
Right, what is Krita, and where does Krita come from? This is Krita around 1999. It wasn't very usable, but you could paint. And over the years, Krita got developed, fell down, restarted, until around 2003, we really began to develop and really began to make progress to real releases. Right, we've got a past, really disappointing past, and I see four people here in the front row who know about our past. In 1998, someone wrote a hack. Wrote a script that converted the user interface of the GIMP from GPK to Qt, and thought, well, I've made a Qt hack. Maybe some people are interested, but that was a bit of a mistake. And the Qt hack didn't go any further. So, in a fit of pique, one of my predecessors said, we'll do it ourselves. We're going to create a Photoshop clone, which we'll just call Kirishop, a K for KE, image for Photoshop for Shop. And we can do that in, well, like 6 months. I'm afraid that my dear predecessor was wrong. And when it turned out that he was wrong, we stopped developing, and development fell down, and nothing happened. Until, about a year later, someone else said, well, I'll pick it up, and I'm going to make it really great. And then development dropped down, because it was just all by his lonesome. Another attempt, another name, another lawyer who complained about a name, current name is Krita, and people often ask me, what does that mean? That's not a name. You can't even pronounce it in English, right? Well, it was just about the only name we knew we wouldn't get legal problems with. It's Swedish for chalk, or pencil, so it's somehow a little bit relevant, and it stuck. And we're starting to get some name recognition. Around 2003, development had all but died again. Krita wasn't even included on the Linux distributions anymore. And then I got a graphics tablet for my birthday, and I thought, well, I want a hack. So I started hacking. My very first hack, Krita couldn't even paint at that time. And I wanted to make this a painting application. Not just manipulating existing images, but painting from scratch. My very first hack was to make Krita draw little red squares. And if you push really hard with your tablet stylus, you would get big, dark, red squares. And from that point on, everything just started to roll. Apparently, people thought, well, if he can do that, I can do something useful too. And people started coming in and doing useful stuff. And then development really took off. In 2004, we had an application you could paint with, you could manipulate photos, filters, plugins, everything was in very early stage, impressive. So in 2005, we had our first release. At that time, Krita was just about as capable as, say, Microsoft Paint with layers. But progress. 2006, two more releases. And by now, we are porting Krita to Qt4, and that's going to be even more exciting. Let's see what Krita can do right now.
So, there is a list of what Krita can do. In fact, it can do a lot more, but we can cover all the aspects in this presentation. So, there is a short list. So, obviously, Krita can manipulate raster images, the whole point of the stuff. And You can load the existing images, modify them, change the contrast, etc. You can create image from scratch, paint with your tablet or whatever. And one of the important aspects of Krita is that the color is correct. Use color management and profile. So if you have a well profiled screen and a good profile for your printer, the color you see on the screen, the color you get on the print. And of course, with the color management, we get support for a lot of various color space, like RGB or CMYK, lab, grayscale, and even watercolor, since a little bit an experimentation in the current version of Krita. It's a simulation of real watercolor. So the goal of Krita is to have to paint, and like you can paint on the real life, and the goal is to be able to paint to get the same results with the computer program. We can support more than higher depth precision for channels to 8, 16 bits or even more. We can support HDR imaging. We can mix the pixel, text, vectors. And we have also the possibility to group layers and apply the effects on them, etc.
We have. Can you vectorize alpha maps? Alpha translate your layers and vectors?
And of course, you can extend it either on C++ or with scripts and Python in Ruby.
Right, color management. You can see here in this collage a couple of things that are interesting about our color management. Let's start here. An image is associated with a particular color space, like CYK, like RGB, like LAB, or anything else. Associated with the color space is a profile. A profile tells you exactly colors on the computer are just numbers, right? If you've got 3-channel RGB, 8-bit, you've got 3 numbers. But those numbers don't mean anything, really, unless you can relate them to something physical, like a computer screen, like printer, like ink, or what your camera sees or what your scanner sees. Those profiles describe that part of it. They make the numbers that make up your image real. But you are not limited by having one color space per image. Every layer can have its own color space in Krita. Look at this. This image is RGB 16-bit. The second layer is LAB. Of course, that's not particularly useful, but you can mix grayscale layers with RGB layers, and that's a lot more useful, for instance, when you're coloring in line art. We've got almost the whole gamut of preferences that our preferred color management library, which is a little CMS, where it's going to have a presentation to at this conference, offers. Few things are missing yet. For instance, out of gamut warnings. We were going to have a sum of color project for that, but that fell just on the wrong side of the mark. We're having 2 sum of color projects, but out of gamut warning isn't in it. Fortunately, it's very easy to add, and it's probably in 2 of X. Now, pixels, text, and vectors. In 1.6, that's maybe a little overstatement. You can draw with vectors. As soon as you press OK, the vectors disappear and become pixels. On the other hand, it's very easy to work with right now. Next version of Krita, we will integrate all the vector goodness from the KFS vector application Carbon right inside Krita in a very pleasant and fun way. Text. There are 2 ways to add text in the current version of Krita. The first one that all of you can install if you're using Linux. One way is to use the text tool. Text tool is fairly simple. You select a font, you type the text, you press OK, you've got pixels. Pixels are the shape of text. The other way is editable, and that means that you're embedding an entire K-office text frame right inside your image, which means you can mix bold and italic and mix fonts, mix paragraphs just in one text box. And for the pixel part, you can paint. You can paint using straight lines, squares, ellipses, triangles, Z curves, and even stars. Our children love.
Yes.
Krita is a layered image application, just like every serious image, raster image application since the first version of Photoshop that supported layers. It's layers with layers too. You've in fact got four types of layers: paint layers and the layer you paint on. That's pretty obvious, but essential. An object layer is one of those layers that contain, for instance, a keyword text frame, or a K-char chart, or maybe, if you want to be really silly, a K-spread spreadsheet, right, embedded in your image. That's an object layer. Object layers, I have to add, will be gone in 2.0, because we've got something better. Adjustment layers are like filters you place right in your layer stack. They are like foils you put on your image, or like the filters you can put on your camera, or on those enlargement apparatus that people used to use before digital cameras. They can have an effect, they have an associated mask, and they are editable. You can change them later on. And finally, group layers. Group layers are pretty useful for a couple of reasons. For instance, I said group layers fixate the layers in their group. You can still edit those layers, of course, and then the result changes. But it makes Krita perform a lot better, because when you try to get a final result, the results of the group layers are used, and not the layers inside the group are recommended. Right, group layers can be nested. You can have an endless nest of groups, if you like that. There's one limitation: object layers must be on top of the group layers. Right, more about adjustment layers. Adjustment layers, as you can see, have an associated mask that you can add. You can paint on this mask. I've just made a simple circle, but you can make anything. You add a filter. Almost any filter works. I have to warn you, if you use a filter that has random effects, then whenever you change something, the random effect will randomly change too, naturally. For instance, this is a brightness contrast filter that filters the brightness contrast of a too dark snapshot of my new house. I think adjustment layers are quite a bit of fun. They may be 1990s, like Peter Sigmund said yesterday, but they are still a lot of fun. And like I said, you save your image, you load it again, you can change the values. Finally, scripting.
So, I think one of the most important things for an application to be successful is to be easily extensible, because obviously we are a limited team, we have a limited time available, and it must be easy for users to add the features they need for their work, or to automate the system. So we have scripting in Krita. We are currently in the current stack version with Python and Ruby. We have made built a system for K-office to have the same API for all the scripting languages, to avoid having some languages being less supported than others. So it's integrated in the GUI, and especially you can there's a dialogue where you can download other scripts from the internet and click, and then the script is available to be using the interface.
Right, that was Krita as it is now, and as it will be for people who don't use our Subversion source code repository for, I guess, another 9 months. Because we are working with, doesn't it work?
No, just a question about how it is now. You haven't spoken about the support for finding like when I want to migrate from Adobe Photoshop.
Adobe Photoshop is a disaster. I know that Frans Smit from Scribus has reverse engineered the Photoshop file format, and we are looking into reusing that. That's not really easy, and at the same time, there's another library that's being right now created, LibPSD, that supports loading modern Photoshop files. The big problem is that Adobe has closed down their Photoshop file format. And when I, 2 years ago, mailed someone at Adobe, I had contact with, and I asked him, look, I'm making this nice new raster image application that's never going to be any sort of threat to your Photoshop. Could I have the SDK for Photoshop CS2? And he said, oh, sure, nice work of you. I'm going to make sure you're going to get that. 2 weeks later, he came back to me and he said, I'm sorry, can't do that, legal forbids it. So the Photoshop file format, since Photoshop 6 is closed, proprietary, undocumented, and if you want to see the documentation, you have to sign an NDA and promise never to write free software at all. I'm not going to sign that. I'm not going to support it. So Photoshop 6 files you can import. You can import TIFF files, you can import RAW files, you can import PNG, JPEG, BMP, all that stuff, but not Photoshop.
It is interesting to know that in Photoshop itself, there is, when you save a Photoshop file, a compatibility option that will make sure they don't use newer extensions that are on file format or compatibility with third-party applications that are not open source software. But that seems to also have a problem with compatibility. So basically, it looks like even internally, it's a mess by itself because they are unable to be provided even for other applications that are not open source.
If you read through the Photoshop 6 file format documentation, it's clear that this is a file format that originated in the 1980s and has been developed since then. And, well, you know, next talk, as you will be about OpenRaster, which is going to be the standard interchange format for layered raster applications. And that's what I'm getting all my hopes for. I'm not going to work on OpenRaster. Petition only. You're their customer. At least, unless you fire at the software. You're their customer. You've got to copy this on it. You have to contact Adobe. If you're not Adobe customers, contact Adobe. Adobe will open them. They listen to their customers. They don't listen to us. Because I've never bought a copy of Adobe software. Yes, that's the file format. And that's really great because that's open, that's public, that's developed, it's got good libraries, good documentation. EXR is just great.
Yes,
Yes,
I
want to
say that our open raster is finished and we have something to gain on to be able to exchange between the game and Krita and other open source projects. I intend to spend some time to get a converter from PSD to open raster so that people who want to make the migration will be able to convert to open raster and then use whatever they want in the open source world. But it's maybe in 1 year or 2 years, I don't know yet.
Who knows, maybe someone will make a plugin for Photoshop and get rich. That's possible. Right. The future of Krita. That's what we are working on real hard right now. It's taking quite a bit of time because we are making quite a lot of large moves. I summarized them. Shapes. That seamless mixing of pixels, vectors, and text. And we mean it. I'll show you how that works a bit later on. Even more core spaces, thanks to a bit of serious refactoring. our color space code is now really simple, and it takes maybe 4 hours to add a new color space. I'm working on GPU accelerated filters. That's more or less just for fun, because they will never be really accurate. We are.
Why do you think GPU is not accurate?
Because of limitations in the number formats in graphics cards. They don't have all the same number formats.
Well, what number format do you want?
I don't know. That's just what I learned when I was hacking.
Oh, because we have 32-bit IEEE plus.
Let's talk right after the talk.
He's an ad.
We'll grab each other. Slashes, masks, painterly overlays, those are right now in Krita 1.6, you don't have a global selection. That comes as a surprise to a lot of users. And it came as a surprise to me that it came as a surprise to a lot of users, because it never ceased to surprise me in all the graphics applications that when I selected a couple of pixels in one layer, I went to a second layer, that my selection would somehow no longer apply to the pixels I used for the selection. But we listen to our users, and we have some, I think, pretty good ideas to make working with selections a lot more powerful. We finally added noise resolution. We didn't have that. Just pixel is a pixel is a pixel. None of that stuff is centimeters and inches and lots per inch, pixels per inch. We are having that now. Tone mapping, breaking to HDR, that's yours department. I don't claim to understand it. Natural linear simulation is my department. I love that stuff. Ever when I saw a demonstration of someone with a retina computer program where I could just paint and move junk around on this virtual canvas, I was really impressed. Yes?
Do you like people to grow up?
Yes? That's okay. And finally, we hope to make quite a few performance improvements. For 1.6, we concentrated on getting the feature list reasonably complete and reasonably stable, and didn't pay too much attention to reasonably fast. So you need a very fast computer to have a reasonable performance with 1.6. 2.0 should be better. Shapes. That's what we call the objects that you can use to make a combined document in KOffice. Krita is a KOffice application. We are part of the creative part of KOffice. We've also got the business part of KOffice with a spreadsheet and a project planner. We are the part that does text, graphics, texture and data. Now, look at this. This is a three-layer image with background, some pixels, and a shape layer. On the shape layer, we've got a text. You drag the text from this box onto your canvas, place it, start typing. You got not too little, not too much, not so much it gets confusing user interface. You can make things bold, you can make things italic, you can change fonts, you can have new paragraphs. This is just the sample text you see where you drag and drop. You can shape the borders of the text so it can indent here and indent there. You can add vector graphics like a circle with a gradient in it. You can add a gradient on screen and it stays a vector. You save it as a vector, you load it as a vector, you can convert the vector to a selection. For instance, you can convert the vector to pixels. You can add an adjustment layer on top, so you can have a very noisy circle, if you use the noise filter, for instance. And that's going to be really powerful. I'm not claiming that it's really original, because years ago, Gobi Productive, an office suite for BOS, already could do this kind of stuff, but I haven't seen it elsewhere. BOS. Well, it didn't exist, right? Or is the forbidden word? I put a couple of other items here. You can make connections between these shapes and then group them and move them and have lines between them. You can put tables in. You can even put sheet music in. That's my personal pet project. It's a Google Sum of Code project. where a desk unit is going to make it possible to embed sheet music in any KMS application, including Krita. Right, this is again for you.
Yes, so for color management, in fact, in the next version, we have decided to share it with the rest of CarOffice. So now all the shape we have seen in the previous slide will be color management as well in Carbon or on Krita. And we have also focused on cleaning a little bit the stuff from there, because in the previous version, in fact, we are, I think we have reached a point where we have 60% of the code which was a copy past between files. It was a big problem to manage this stuff, because if we had to fix a bug in one file, it was somewhere we had to duplicate the fix in like 10 files. So this has been changed. We plan to add an out-of-game warning. It's important for quick race, especially. One of the things we are adding also is per-channel filtering, because in the current version of Krita, when you take an image and you want to apply a filter, you cannot say, I want only to apply this filter on the red channel, or more importantly, on the label color space, you want to be able to manipulate only the L channel for getting special effects.
Right, this is about selections. And, well, there are lots of users here, and I would love to talk to some users afterwards to see whether my ideas on selections are going to be really as good as I think they are. Selections have grown through the ages, ever since the very first version of MacFame that had the very first bit mask for selections, to a system where you've got selections, where you get masks, where you get channels, and so on. And they all have a selection-like purpose. At least that's what I think. We are going to try to make four types of selections that are applicable to a single layer. And then there's a global selection that works on all layers. And of course, you're going to be able to drag and drop the selection from one layer to another, copy it, paste it, merge them, and so on. That's a given if we get enough time to cover that stuff. Select pictures for changing, a protection mask. That's the most usual kind of thing. You select a couple of pixels, and the pixels you haven't selected aren't affected by at all. Now, select pixels for reading and changing is a bit different. If you have, for instance, a kind of filter that spreads its effect, you want to read selected pixels for one layer and change only selected pixels on another layer. And that's what this is going to provide. Select pixels for filtering non-destructively, that's an effect mask. We're going to have masks that are just selections associated with the layer and the filter, and you can stack them. So we've got adjustment layers that adjust a stack of layers, and we're going to have a stack of effects that adjust a single layer. And finally, the opacity mask is what the most used masks are usually used for, to make a layer more or less transparent, non-destructively. Then, global selections and painterly overlays. That's part of our Google Summer of Code project. We want to have fun stuff like wetness. Make a global image, make it wet. Start painting and smearing. Add gravity. Already in 1988, an English researcher wrote a PhD dissertation in which he described how you could paint gravity on painting, and then the wet ink would drip in the direction of the gravity, and that's always down. You can make the gravity up. That's something we are researching. Viscosity, stickiness, all that kind of stuff. Yes?
That's sort of about boundaries. Are you speaking about images that don't have boundaries, like electricity stand making?
No, direct, we haven't thought about those.
That's something that I'm going to talk about later.
Okay.
Do you want to come?
Sure. Right. Selection visualizations. Ever since the author of MacPain sold a beer of Adford in California with its marching ants waterfall, we've had marching ants. Well, that's true. I did my research. You can also show selections of moths. Marching ants have, as it's a particular problem, that you don't see that a selected pixel is not just on or off, but can be 50% selected. Masks can show that. And we're researching other types of selection visualization as part of Google Sum of Code project. Not sure what will come out of it. The marching ants are working. Krita 106 only had the mask visualization of selections. Right. Document resolution. It's new for us. I didn't believe it was useful, but apparently it is. But then I'm an amateur. I'm not a real graphics user. We've got it. You can say pixels per inch or centimeter, you can have a resolution. That works already. It works with the resolution of your screen, with the resolution of your printer. It 100% makes sure that if you have configured your display correctly, that 1 inch on screen is 1 inch, on paper is 1 real inch. Now, there's another problem. When you start mixing text, pixels, and vectors, what are you going to get? Vectors don't have resolution, but your output device has resolution. And we have decided that the resolution of your image is the resolution of your vectors. That way, if you zoom in, you can, with your vector text, is going to get blocked. I'm sure we're going to get bug reports about that. It's going to stay that way. Because that way you can see how the pixels that will be printed or rendered on screen blend with the pixels you've drawn in your raster image. That's much more accurate.
Okay, I'm talking about high dynamic range of imaging. So in fact, it's already possible in the current stable version to load an XR image and adjust the intensity. I don't know if all the people in the room are aware of what is HDR imaging, so I will explain a little bit. When you take, I don't know if you see when the image don't look great. So when you took an image of a building with a camera, usually you have a very light part here, over here, here, or very dark, and the camera adjusts to take the middle of the color, and you lost information over here and over here. And with a HDR image, you can keep that information. And if you change in a software the what we call the exposure of the image, you can see apparently more information. Not very great in this presentation, but maybe over here you can see a little bit better. So why you can see those images in the current stable version and play with the exposure? You can create them. That's what we have adding, added in the development version. So you take with your camera the bracketing of images as with different speed, and then you can combine them and get an HDR image. And then what you want to do with this image is to create an image where all the part of the image will get at a good exposure so that you can see all the information. That part is part of Google Summer of Code project with the OpenECC working group.
natural media. That's why I started coding in Krita, because I got that little tablet and I wanted to paint, and I found something that I could paint with that I could legally download and alter the code of. This is a collage of what we have got now. Krita 1.6 has got a watercolor simulation that's based on Red Levine's Wet Dreams proof of concept code. It's really old code. It's not a new concept, but it's never been generally available before. What this is, it's a single layer that includes water, canvas ink, and 8 color channels. The 8 color channels mean that when you mix two colors, you get the realistic result. If you mix RGB colors, you don't get the same result you get when you mix real paint. If you mix these kinds of colors, you're going to come close. Then there's wetness, and the wetness dries into the canvas, dries onto the air, makes the paint spread out, and it gives the famous watercolor image effect. It doesn't work perfectly yet. It is experimental. There are a couple of issues we just didn't know we would encounter, like undo. If the image is permanently changing, what does undo mean? You can't just undo a paint stroke that's been blended into paint strokes that were there before. In the current version of Krita, we will be able to add wetness and gravity absorbency, etc., as masks, as layers, as adjustment layer, adjustment overlays to each layer. So you can make an RGB image wet. And as soon as a layer is wet, you won't be able to undo all of it until we find a solution for that. Oh, this is a nice story. You can select which channels are shown for each layer. That's part of the color thing. Another thing we're working on is brush simulation. It's still very experimental. This is what Cyril is working on right now. We are trying to simulate the hairs of a brush. Just not as many as a real brush have, a subset of hairs. Each hair can have a color. The hairs can meet of the brush and then exchange color, mix, etc. And we've already got hairs in different random colors right now. That should be right in the next release version of Krita without random colors. Maybe it's an option. Right, that was about it. Questions? Perhaps answers? If you want to ask a question in French, you can do that. Zinus speaks French. I don't know. I think we need a microphone for this. Louis, have you got the portable microphone? It's just like a real room.
You said that Krita is fully integrated with the key office. Is it integrated with OpenOffice?
No. I mean, OpenOffice is a completely different environment. You won't be able to, unless the OpenOffice guys decide that they want to support our shape interfaces, you won't be able to put a shape into OpenOffice. That's just not feasible. So behind the back.
I saw your name for your color management system, which is called Pigment. Is this just a working file, or is this meant to be the final name of the color management system you are using?
We were not supposed to be the final name, yes.
Because I'm asking this, there is another project from Blender, which is also called Pigment, which is has nothing to do with color management, but there's a rich application API on top of OpenGL, and just want to hint that this could maybe lead to some confusion if open source projects have the same name but actually deal with two totally different things. So,
well, that would be awkward, yes. Well, we'll think of that. Of course, Pigment is not going to be released separately on K-Office, but it's going to be to include a pigment.so. So, yes, well, we'll think of that. We're not married to that name.
Okay.
How much tablet support do you have? I mean, you have pressure, but what else do you have? Tilt and these other things?
We just have pressure at the moment. The big problem is that we don't, none of us have tablets that support tilt and rotation and so on. They're awfully expensive. I've tried to get sponsorship for them, but I have failed until now.
I agree that they're okay, but they are in common use by us.
Yes, we really want a couple.
In fact, the new system we are working with a dynamic brush will have tilt support.
Unless we have hardware to test it with, we won't know what the tilt support
will be. I have hardware to test it.
You have got it. Good one.
So, now when I need to channel my white, could you please make it that when you select a brush and you set exactly how you want it, and then you go to another brush, go back to the first one, but it remembers all the settings that you have, instead of having to reset them every single downtime, like for a paper frame to do.
Yes, well, I can imagine that would be awkward. One thing we thought of was using the fact that Wacom styluses have unique IDs to just say, well, buy a gem jar full of Wacom styluses, label them, and do like real paper with real brushes, because that's already 1.6 true. You don't have one active tool. You have one active tool per pointing device. So your mouse is a tool, your eraser tip is a tool, your stylus is a tool, your airbrush is a tool.
If you have to buy 10 stylus, yeah, then that's expensive. But being able to sort of dock this brush and say, I want to save this one for later, and then just click on that make on, you have all the settings back.
Yes, that's a good idea.
Switching between tools is really common. I mean, not just an eraser, but, you know, a pencil and then the brush to ink in and then back to the pen and then back.
Yes, and just those different size brushes. Yeah. Yes, that's a good point. And we will take it in consideration and try to code it. More questions?
It's about HDR editing. Not everybody can afford those $50,000 screens. So how do you allow us to edit into an HDR file?
Well, you set the exposure. The problem of the current version is that when you want to edit, maybe add a text or something like that, you can only do this in the 0 to 1 range. That's something I plan to change. So you set the exposure, and you modify the image, and it's modified for that exposure, if you see what I mean. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. Okay. So one last question.
Est-il possible de reproduire des brushes, genre grunge, savez-vous de quoi je parle?
La brush ou
grunge, G-R-U-N-G-E. Déchirer, on va dire. Déchirer des branches, des brushes, déchirer.
Déchirer, c'est-à-dire couper en deux?
Non, c'est... Vous savez pas de quoi je me parle?
Non, pas du tout.
It's like you take a real brush and you dipped it, but there wasn't a lot of paint. So when you make your line, there's also spaces. It's not quite,
yeah,
it's
sure.
Not beautiful, it's rough.
Yeah. We want that.
Yes, sir.
A prime version. That's what we are working on. Yes. So like when the hashes rush gets spread out and you get a splattery effect.
Jagged edges or spaces inside.
I've got a bit that already works. Well, I'm not satisfied, so I haven't shown the screenshot where you can do that with a Chinese simulated Chinese paintbrush.
Okay, thanks. That's okay. We're on time.